Okay, so here's a quick 45-second announcement before I start the video. Please watch this, please, I'm begging you. It seems that ever since I released my last band recommendations video, a lot of people have taken it upon themselves to send me suggestions of their own. The thing is, commenting, hitting me up on Twitter, Instagram, etc. is crazy for me to keep up with. I would love to hear what you're sending me, and I am in desperate need of new jams, so I am partnering up with Amino. Basically, I'm opening up a page over there. You can send me one song to listen to. I'll jam out to it, and I'll provide you with like a quick rating. I'll be doing that for like the next 7 days after this video is out. You may be wondering, what is Amino? You can chill out with other groups of nerds who are into the weird stuff that you are. For example, Baldi's Basics? Yep, you're covered. Anime? Yep. LGBTQAI+? Yes. Serial killers? Musicals? Harry Potter? I know a lot of my viewers are into K-pop. Yep, everything is there. You can make friends and talk via voice chat or text if you have anxiety to talk with other people, you know, like over phone, like the rest of society. You can interact with new homies with live events like drawing contests, polls, debates, just a lot of really cool stuff so you never have to look up from your phone again. Also, just a lot of love to Amino for sponsoring this anyway. I'm 18 years old, I'm saving up to move out of my house, it's daunting, especially living off of YouTube cash, they are wonderful. Just check in the subscription and come see me on Amino and I'll tell you whatever I think of any song you send me, as long as it's not by Primus or the Red Hot Chili Peppers. Alright, on with the video! Hello, my name is Nate and I have a sense of authority and self-importance regarding music taste, and it's largely inflated more than the average person just because I can put my opinions into words and I have a YouTube channel with a sub count with 6 figures. That means that all the bands I'm gonna recommend are objectively great.
But Nate, all music is subjective and everyone has a right to their own opinion.
Talk to me when you achieve a small YouTube milestone. The sub count hasn't gotten to my head, I promise. Like last time, the bands are sorted into 3 categories. Bands that you have heard of, mainstream stuff that I enjoy, bands that you might have heard of, stuff that's off the beaten path but still not super underground, and bands that you have not heard of, stuff that is obscure as frick and it's hard to track down. Every band will have a song recommendation. This song is not always, in my opinion, their best song, but rather one that captures the general sound and vibe the best. Just remember that so you're not like, but why'd you pick that when this song's better? I'm like, shut up. It's not about quality, it's about like the vibe that it gives off. So let's start with the bands that you have heard of. Chance the Rapper. Chance killed it 2016 through 2017, and he deserved every ounce of recognition and success that he got. I saw him at Sasquatch 2017, and he was phenomenal on stage. He has like this Mr. Rogers vibe, which is wonderful, and he was inclusive and warm. His music matches his stage presence, creating a comforting, bouncy, upbeat, and positive atmosphere that is achieved through wholesome lyrics and colorful textures. He got gospel choirs, he got horns, he got strings, he got piano, he's got steel drums in like one song. Chance has an eye for cinematic and thematical elements that is completely unmatched in the mainstream music scene right now. Everything that he does feels genuine and it's from the heart. He's a dude with a really strong vision and he's so cool. You can tell that he loves the things he's singing about, his family, his friends, all the people who admire his music. Like, if I'm having a bad day, I just jam out to Chance. I highly recommend All We Got. If you don't smile while listening to this, you don't have a soul. John Bellion, confession time. When I went to go see 21 Pilots' Emotional Road show in Boise, I was more excited to see John Bellion than I was to see 21 Pilots. Sue me. This dude gets what other homegrown SoundCloud artists don't. Vision and dynamics. That's what sets him apart. He's got tinges of hip-hop, lots of pop, and a lot of other major alternative influences going on. When John makes a song, he creates a scene that contributes to a cohesive vision in the album. This is really clear and apparent in his last 2 albums, The Human Condition and The Definition. The Definition feels quiet, dark, nostalgic, and atmosphere-focused, while The Human Condition is extremely bombastic and colorful and cinematic. Is he the next Kanye West? Nah, but he's not really trying to be. Go into his music expecting something colorful and fun, short on substance, but high in terms of production value and style. Listen to Morning in America. Fall Out Boy, asterisk. New Fall Out Boy is bad, and they were only good when they were super emo sad rock from 2000s. Everything else is super terrible. Okay, just stop. Get off your high horse and learn to have some fun for once. I am not a super big fan of emo Fall Out Boy. It's all fine and serviceable music that I have no issue with, I just never found myself compelled to go out of my way to listen to it. It all felt kinda samey. There wasn't ever enough change in dynamics or sound or setting the way Panic or My Chemical Romance did with their music. Their jams had similar song structures, sounds, melodies, and nothing really stuck out in my mind, and I was kinda turned off. But then I jammed out to Save Rock and Roll and American Beauty, American Psycho, and I was blown blown away. The song sounded different. There were dynamics and theatrics. Was it more modern pop and mainstream appeal? Sure, but that doesn't take away from the unique direction that they were trying to take their music. Then I found out that people often regard these two albums as their worst. No, I strongly disagree. Those are like my two favorites by them. Save Rock and Roll is like a globe-trotting romp exploring audience expectations, concerns with the future of the genre, and their struggle to stay relevant to fans. The stylistic changes are bold and brave, and I commend them. American Beauty, American Psycho is my favorite album by them, with a melancholy, cynical, suburban vibe about it. It feels like a summer album, and that captured the cynical and drastic highs and lows of summer as a young teenager perfectly. It's really nostalgic to me, and it builds a distinct and darkly mundane atmosphere about it. On top of being loud, exciting, varied, and the golden word here, dynamic. Give these two albums a listen, and listen to 4th of July. Fun. Where did Fun go? They blew up hardcore and then they disappeared, and I missed them. They never had their chance to really grow and develop as much as they should have. For such a mainstream band, they went to some really dark and disturbing places. What kind of mental toll does fame have on somebody? Their album Some Nights paints a misleadingly dark and possibly autobiographical portrait of a band spiraling out of control under the spotlight. Mortality, disillusion of love, conflicted closure, balancing public attention with personal friendships. This is like a super heavy album. But yeah, Mom, they're that one band with the really exciting and catchy song with the woes and the stomp clapping. That's too bad. It seems most audiences have never really decided to delve into their music more critically. It's incredible. Listen to Some Nights intro and then Some Nights in that order, back to back. It's got like a Queen vibe almost. Some Nights becomes a lot sadder when you have the context of the entire album. Like, look up the lyrics. It's a lot darker than you remember. Childish Gambino. Donald Glover can do absolutely nothing wrong, apparently. Stand-up comedy? He kills. Comedic acting? Nailed it. Rapping? Awesome. Directing and writing? What? He's amazing! Dramatic acting? Holy cow, he's good at that too. Funk and psychedelic? Look at that, he just won a Grammy. He's a master at everything that he sets out to do, and I honestly believe that he's the greatest artist in my generation. He is like my biggest role model by far. A lot of Donald Glover's work has really opened my eyes and inspired me to learn more about black culture and black art too. His entire Camp album is a remarkable exploration about growing up black but not quite fitting in with the local culture and whatnot. Although he doesn't just talk about race politics in his work, his other stuff looks at the creative process, existentialism, perceptions of fame, fatherhood. I love Childish Gambino, in case you can't tell. Listen to Outside and Me and Your Mama, since they're like super different stylistically. Arctic Monkeys, OMG Arctic Monkeys. You mean, are you mine? Why do you only call me when you're high? No, I'm talking Brian Storm. I'm talking Teddy Picker. I bet you look good on the dance floor. You know, when the Arctic Monkeys were like going through their alternative punk rock phase, they crushed it. They were fast, aggressive, clever. Their older albums were almost exhaustingly energetic and thrilling. I'm not really all that much of a fan of their materials after Suck It and See. They used to be a great and imaginative Brit rock group. To this day, I consider Do Me a Favor to be one of the most satisfying songs ever written. It's literally in like my all-time favorite five songs. It is so good. Please listen to it. The ending smashes your face in. Imagine Dragons. So, I went to my first concert when I was 12. I saw AWOL Nation in a small venue in Boise. One band came on stage and they're like, hi, we're from Vegas and we're called Imagine Dragons. Nobody knew who they were. Then they started playing and they melted everybody's faces. They were fantastic. They were upbeat, colorful, passionate. I turned to my dad and I was like, these guys are gonna get big. And I was totally right. Their early material was so punchy, fun, and something that would eventually leave their sound melodic. Everything that they made, Night Visions and before, is excellent. Oddly enough, it seems that the bonus tracks attached to their albums are better than like the actual meats of each release. After Radioactive was such a runaway success, the record label was like, hey, do you want to make all of your music dark and poundy from now on? Melody, harmony, hooks? Nah, we just want some bass drum from now on. If MMA fights can't play your music in their ads, we do not want it. Everything needs to sound moody, angry, and just bass drum. Did we mention bass drum? So much bass drum. And that sucks because Imagine Dragons sounds their best when they're upbeat and fun. Hear Cha-Ching by them. It is nothing like Radioactive, and it's probably not what you're expecting. Let them surprise you. Despite their bad reputation, this band has some excellent work underneath their belts. Now here are some of the bands that you might have heard of. Pup. So everybody told me to listen to Pup. It was like one of those bands that I knew I'd like if I gave them a shot. I just couldn't find time to sit down and really invest. I eventually did, and I'm very glad that I did. I'm discovering that I am a really big fan of dance punk. Like, fancy that. Their sound is insane and wild and unhinged. They're unpredictable and loud, and they have enough pop tinge to stay mainstream in your hometown's music scene. The vocals are screamy enough that grandma doesn't like them, but they're legible enough that my dad can appreciate them. The guitars are just heavy enough to have a hardcore vibe, but every song has enough of a hook to let you cling on to them and differentiate every song from each other. And that's kind of an issue in this genre, you know, because everything kind of tends to melt together, not with Pup. It doesn't feel samey, and that's a really big compliment. Please listen to DVP by them. Taking Back Sunday, imagine a 2005 teen high school movie. The angst, the betrayal, the romance, the heartbreak. It's dramatic and campy and exciting. Taking Back Sunday captured that vibe fantastically with their early work. 2000s emo pop punk was kind of a special genre, and they were the kings back in their day. They were masters of their craft. Their mascara was on point, the hair was straightened perfectly, and the fans cried at all of their shows and they screamed along with all the anthems. They were brilliant. The sad thing is, though, is that emo kind of quit being cool around 2009. What is a band to do? Well, Taking Back Sunday changed. They went from the sad rock to the arena rock kind of thing. Their songs became more mature, profound, and thoughtful. Their sound was different, but every song was still fantastic. Even though everything that they make is different, it still is solid, it's still smart. Congratulations, guys, you did what a lot of bands can't do. Evolve. Listen to A Decade Under the Influence. That is, like, my favorite song ever to play live with a band. The Frights. You know the kind of music that they play at KFC, like the old-timey doo-wop stuff? Throw in some electric guitar and yelling and now you have The Frights. They're quirky, they're lively, and unique with their own sound that I haven't found anywhere else. What's it like being a poor millennial? Well, these guys will tell you with their music that will confuse your grandma and make college kids mosh while snapping their fingers. This new wave of California alternative punk is like shaping the scene, and The Frights are like totally leading the charge. They're fantastic. Listen to Crust Bucket. It starts off slow, but then it picks up hardcore as it goes on. Give it a shot. Slaughter Beach Dog. Remember that family vacation that you went on when you were a little kid? You went to a coastal town and everything was gray and relaxed. The sand was wet and gross, but it was still kind of nice. The air was nippy and cold. You just sat in the beach house and looked out the window. Things were like really low key and really pleasant. The warm fuzzy vibe you got in your stomach? Yeah, all those things are this band. Slaughter Beach Dog is a great band to do housework and entertain guests to. It's a far cry from Modern Baseball, the singer's other project. It's very serene, it's really peaceful, it's very atmospheric. There's not really much to say besides the fact that they're just great to listen to while you're hanging out. Play it in the background of a dinner party or whatever you have. They're really nice. Listen to Golden Green. Chef Special. These guys are from the Netherlands and they're like a super fantastic beach party kind of band. They got clicky, groovy guitar riffs and some bouncy synth and suave vocals. They're super fun and great to dance to. I know they have like a ton of other music out, but I'm just restricting myself to what's available on Spotify. I'm chill with that too because their songs that they have out are like already fantastic and energetic. Apparently they open for 21 Pilots, which is super fitting. Hopefully they come out with some new music soon because I need more. Listen to Peculiar by them. Spooky Ghost Boy. So there's like this deep, dark, soft, sad boy trend I see going on. A lot of artsy former emo kids are playing guitar and it's super reverbed and it's in space with layered vocals and 80s synths or whatever. I would be intrigued in that style if it was just one artist, but it's like so specific and it's kind of off-putting to see other people replicating it. Correct me if I'm wrong, but Spooky Ghost Boy kind of introduced the whole vibe and popularized it. Every 17-year-old kid with an undercut and thick fake glasses are secretly trying to emulate his sound while they're recording on their dad's MacBook at 3 a.m. in the morning in their room, thinking that they're deep, dark, and mysterious. They're not. To be honest, I don't really like Spooky Ghost Boy's synthy reverby stuff anyway. I liked his lo-fi jams. His first two albums are fantastic, and they really helped me get into the lo-fi vibe in the first place. It's minimalist, it's earnest, and it's impactful. It's melancholy, homemade, but it's never really try-hardy. He's the artist who taught me how to really value bedroom production to begin with. It's personal, it's claustrophobic, and it's atmospheric. It's sad and it actually has a reason to be, and it feels super genuine. Listen to Out of Sight because that song will, like, punch you in the heart. Harley Poe, so I want you to imagine if the family from Texas Chainsaw Massacre started a folk band. Banjo, accordion, fiddle, harmonica, mandolin, acoustic guitar, they have the works down. But instead of singing about rivers and girls and other folksy boring stuff, they sing about cannibalistic transvestites and zombies and blowing up schools. Their music is not for the easily offended. They go to some really dark and shocking places just for comedic value. See, there's this inner SJW inside of me, and it's like, Nate, should you really be listening to this? And the part of me that knows how to actually have fun every now and then is like, shut up, they're good, live for once. Their newest album, Lost and Losing It, stepped away from the silly over-the-top stuff and went for more of a weird and introspective vibe. They reflected on the destruction of the lead singer's marriage and him being cheated on. It was horrible. By the way, if you're the type of person to cheat on your romantic partner, you're a jerk and you should stop. You gotta listen to the live version of I Could Always Eat Your Brains by them. It's 8 minutes long and it's awesome. In my opinion, the live version is the only way to listen to this song because they get the entire room singing by the end of it and then the band just crumbles. It's brilliant, it's really funny, it's a lot of fun, they're fantastic. Listen to them, unless you're like super easily offended. I have no idea how to pronounce her name. Let me listen to it. All right, it's Leahy. Yes, it's Alex Leahy. So Alex Leahy is one of the most promising figures in alternative rock right now, next to Jeff Rosenstock. And if you watched the last video, you know how much I love him. Her music is sweeping, it's bouncy, it's a lot of fun. The melodies are sticky and sweet, but they're satisfying with enough punk rock crunch that you don't feel embarrassed listening to her. Her lyrics cover typical millennial struggles about colleges and crushes and being dependent on wine, etc. I know it sounds cliched, but she has enough charm and charisma that she carries everything effortlessly. She's great for parties and friendly hangouts. You should really listen to I Haven't Been Taking Care of Myself. Now, here are some bands that you have not heard of. Saint Terrible. Okay, I put this band on my last recommendations video, but I feel like I didn't do a good enough job describing them. Granted, I know that there is no combination of words that I could ever put together to do them justice. They're from my hometown, Boise, and they have world-class production values and incredibly high concepts. I mean, their music is folksy with banjos and stuff, but there's enough serious existential philosophy undercurrents running through everything that they make to make them really interesting. There's this overarching story that kind of goes through all of their music with characters and events and climaxes and stuff that just pop up throughout the releases. Plus, everything that they do completely adds on to it, from the videos to the music itself to the lyrics to even their awe-inspiring live performances. I think it is so bizarre that they've been making incredible art for this long, yet they're completely unknown. I've been listening to these guys on and off for about a year and a half, but everything seriously came together when I saw them live. If you ever get the chance, see Saint Terrible live. They are an incredible band with fantastic musicians, elaborate costumes and set pieces, there are props. They even have live dancers and performers that are not playing music to pull the whole thing together. And the crazy thing is that their performances are generally fairly small. Every show that I've been to by them has like less than 50 or 60 people in attendance, but they still pour their heart and souls into every aspect of the performance. Okay. Don't tell any of my friends, but I'm convinced that Saint Terrible is the best band in Idaho right now, and they have an incredible future ahead of them. If you listen to one band on this list, I want you to listen to Saint Terrible. They're so fantastic that I'm putting the Youth and Cannibalism at the top of every band recommendations playlist attached to this video. 10 out of 10, amazing, spiritual experience, remarkable, wow. I want to tour with these kids someday. They're the best, please support them. Voxtrot. So, I first heard Voxtrot in middle school and they clicked instantly. They're youthful and they're fast and they're poppy in all the best ways. They have brilliant and catchy melodies and fantastic lyrics. Seriously, the lyrics are so brilliant in every single song that they put out. The production values are so diverse and polished, and it's crazy to think that they're still like kind of a low-end band. I'm gonna like go out on a limb and say that their Raised by Wolves EP is one of my all-time favorites. They're nostalgic, emotional, exciting, and their lifespan ended way too soon. Rest in peace, Voxtrot. Listen to Missing Pieces. I dare you not to love it. Oh, hello! Sure, you got musicians like 21 Pilots and Vance Joy and even Fall Out Boy sometimes who dabble with ukulele, but Oh Hello demolishes it. They're like ukulele gods. They brilliantly do layers and harmonies, and they create these crazy songs with just ukuleles. It's brilliant. Plus, the vocals create like this haunting, spooky atmosphere that sucks you into their wet and reverby goodness. If you like spooky Ghost Boy, you will love Oh Hello. You should definitely listen to Haunted House by them. The Homeless Gospel Choir. Hey you! Do you like the Daily Stormer? Corporate interference in the government? Fascism? Imperialism? What's that? No? Well, I have a like-minded individual for you. It is no secret that I like Derek Sinetti quite a bit. He's the narrator in my Death Poem series. He has a fantastic music project too. He's kind of like Woody Guthrie, where he writes mostly traditional folk music, minus the racism that kind of inherently comes with the genre half the time. Derek Sinetti takes his platform and talent and he pushes social awareness for positive and upbeat political political vibes. Basically, he is a social justice warrior, but he is not obnoxious about it. Through using clever stories, songs, poetry, he is able to convey a truly effective message of unity, love, and compassion. Plus, listening to the Homeless Gospel Choir will give you some serious punk cred at any basement show that you end up going to. Just wear a Derrickson Eddy t-shirt and you'll get some mad respect. He is like the underground scene's cool uncle. Listen to When the War is Over. Sculpture Club. So these guys are post-punk with a grungy cigarette-smelling vibe about them. They're gothic the same way The Cure was before they got old and crusty and weird. Yeah, those dudes are way too old to be dressing like that. Man, these kids aren't even from Boise, they're from Salt Lake. I saw them at a gig at Tree Fort Music Festival 2017. They had like a really small show, but they blew the minds of all seven people in the room who saw them. They're dusty and dark, and their music is so moshable while still being accessible. Listen to my favorite, it will kick you in the head. Raccoon Tour. Finally, we have Raccoon Tour. This musical project is brand spanking new. It is so new, in fact, that they only have one song out right now. Granted, it's one of my favorite songs, probably because I wrote it when I was 15 years old and I was super sad. There's ukulele, driving guitar, fast drums, a slippery bass, weird synthy noises, gang vocals, glockenspiels. I am going for some crazy high production values, yo. I'm a fan of music with dynamics and an underlying narrative, and that's kind of the vibe that I'm going for. An album is coming out this summer around like August or September, maybe October, I don't know. Stuff like this takes time, but it's coming. Keep your eyes peeled, it's gonna be rad. Wow, this was shameless, and I thought I'd have more self-respect than this, but if you want to give my jam a listen to, it's in the playlists and such. It's called So Far and Running. I also have a kind of music video out on my channel. If you want to watch it, just click the annoying ribbon at the top of the video. So one of the most annoying things about doing these videos is that everyone has the recommendations for me. They're like, hey Nate, listen to Primus, or hey Nate, listen to the Red Hot Chili Peppers, and I'm like, I don't like trash music, ew. Thanks to Amino, however, I can totally keep track now. Just click on the link below and send me some awesome song suggestions, and I'll rate every single one of them, or at least I'll try. I'm gonna be brutally honest. I'll try to stay active on there for a week after this video is posted. Oh, and like, follow me on Twitter and Instagram and buy shirts or whatever. Links to everything is in the description. Hey, I hope you found some cool new bands. Comment, let me know which new artists you found and like, I don't know. And as always, stay spicy.